Welcome to Decision Point. Today our guest is Evelyn Hines, who has written a profound book about the life of Corrie ten Boom called The Weaving. And she also has a remarkable ministry called Arts Touching Hearts. And so let's hear what she has to say. Welcome, Evelyn.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's good to have you back again. You've written a book called The Weaving, and it says A Journey to Corrie ten Boom Life. Can you explain what that's all about?
Well, when I started performing as Corrie ten Boom, I do have a one-woman show where I dress and present a dramatization of Corrie ten Boom. Mm-hmm. And people, after I finished, they would say, "How did you ever get started doing this?" Mm-hmm. And so I wrote the book to tell how I got started doing it, and what God had worked through my life to make me to be a person who wanted to do this, and also telling other stories about Corrie that had really impacted me and how I related them to my own life.
So it's a combination of a biography of Corrie ten Boom in terms of stories that people may not have heard, and then also your journey in recreating her for
That's
people.
That's right.
Yeah, good. And what kind of reaction are you getting to the book? Are people feeling like they're getting to know Corrie better? Are you inspiring other people to have a ministry like yours? What kind of reaction are you getting?
I think both of those things, actually, which has been kind of surprising to me, but I think my story is another generation of sort of the same principle that happened with Corrie. Corrie could not have imagined her life in her old age. When she was growing up, they were a simple Dutch family, and she ends up traveling around the world, being known by some of the most famous preachers around the world and all that. That she wouldn't have imagined that. But God had prepared her from the time she was a child to do what she did when she was old. Mm-hmm. And then when I look back at my own life, God had been preparing me to do what I'm doing now. And I think those two stories help other people go, "He could be doing that for me." It's very encouraging.
Yeah, that's a great thing. Now, what are some of the ways that God prepared Corrie, even though she was having this, she had a very simple, you know, middle class, I guess, lifestyle, Dutch lifestyle, and, you know, the, 20s and 30s, 1920s and 30s. So how did God prepare her for what she was to do as a speaker and a writer and traveling all over the world?
Well, I read that they always had Corrie out in front in that family. They were a very devout family, and they believed in doing mission work and all kinds of evangelizing. And they would put Corrie out there and say, "You sing a song," or, you know, "You tell this story." And so in that way, she was prepared to be the teacher. Mm-hmm. And she actually had a love of writing when she was young, and she wanted to write a book. And I think the family thought, "Oh, well, you know, this is not going to happen." But then Corrie did end up writing books. So God had put that in her heart.
So God had prepared Corrie in her early life, which is pretty remarkable for what she did. How did God prepare you
in your early life?
Well, I had to first be broken, I think, to be used by God. And so in 1983, my life was a mess. I had been trying to live life the way I thought it should be lived, and I had a real mess. And that involved divorce, and I had a son with illness, and I had a lot of problems.
A lot of problems.
And so in 1983, I decided, I talked to God and said, "You know, I give up, mm-hmm. but I want to go your way, not my way." And I knew that for sure, the bottom of my heart, that I wanted to go God's way. So that is the most profound turning point mm-hmm. in my life. Mm-hmm. And it was shortly after that I learned about Corrie ten Boom. Mm-hmm. But I'd always been a reader, always been a studier, And so it was just natural to me to study about Corrie ten Boom and become interested. And I had a love for acting.
Had you ever done any acting before?
Yes.
So
and
that was one way that you...
I loved that, but I thought, well, that was my old life. Mm-hmm. And there weren't many opportunities, I didn't think, for a Christian to be acting. And so, but anyway, God gives you the desires of your heart.
So he took that old thing and made it new with your acting and your love for reading and researching and literature and people and all of that. And he pulled it all together into this. And so the weaving also tells that story as well, that tapestry. So the image of the weaving, Corrie liked to use that a lot. I mean, what can you explain why you called the book The Weaving?
Yeah. And that's, you know, we're looking at the bottom side of our life, you know, the part of our life that we see. We don't understand how this connects to this, and this is going to, you know, we're too close to it. But from God's viewpoint, he's seeing that he's making a beautiful tapestry. He's the master artist. He knows how to do it. He knows what it takes to make it beautiful. And as human beings, we can't see that.
Yeah, and that's true. Until you get that godly perspective, we can't see the pattern and the beauty. It just kind of looks like a mess, like you're saying there. So there's a wonderful clip that we'd like to show of a scene that you reenact called The Betrayer. Can you set that up for us? Where did this scene come from?
Well, Corrie found out later that her family had been betrayed. The reason they were arrested is that they had been betrayed by a Dutch person. And she did not know that when she went into prison. And so there was the forgiveness of that person that she had to do. And she
so
told
this was someone she knew?
It was,
An acquaintance?
Yeah, an acquaintance.
Mm-hmm. And so let's see how you reenact that and recreate that.
In the camp, a friend from my hometown had come and said, "Do you know who has betrayed you?" And I said, "No." And she told me of this man. His name was Jan Vogel. And I remember him. He had come to the Baye, and he told me a story that he had a wife who hides Jewish people, but she was arrested. But a certain policeman would run the risk to set her free for 600 guilders. And I said, "Oh, I have no money, but what does money mean if it means to save the life of a good woman?" I said, "I will ask my friends. You come later, and I will have that money for you." And you see, the Gestapo had asked him to find out if Corrie ten Boom hides Jewish people. And he thought, "I can do it, and I can make some money." And he made some money, but he betrayed my family. After the war, he was in prison and sentenced to die because he had caused the death of many Dutch people. So I wrote him a letter, and I wrote him, "You have caused the death of four of my family members, and you have caused me much personal suffering in three different prisons. But I have forgiven you because I am a Christian. And you could ask God to forgive you for what you have done. And very soon, I know you are to die, you could go to one of those mansions that Jesus have gone to prepare." I sent him a New Testament with that Way of Salvation underlined. I received back from that man a letter. "Oh, that your God could allow you such a love to forgive me. then I must also accept him. 1 week later, that man was killed. But God had used me, who had hated that man, to bring that man to himself. And the Bible is very clear. If we do not forgive, we have no forgiveness. But the great joy is he gives you the love he demands of you. Forgiveness is a great joy. It is the key that unlocks the door of resentment and those handcuffs of hatred. It is the power that breaks those chains of bitterness and the shackles of selfishness. We never so much touch the ocean of God's love as when we forgive our enemies.
Why did you pick this particular scene, what out of all the scenes that you could reenact from her life?
Because it was another act of forgiveness, and it was an instance where God used Corey to bring that man to salvation. So that was really an important part of her testimony. Mm-hmm. And the message to us is that even though we have hatred for people, God can allow us the power to forgive them and possibly to bring them to a knowledge of Christ.
And Corey and you both have a huge love for the Jewish people in Israel. And why is that?
Well, I will tell my story on that, which is probably a lot like a lot of people. I went to a church in America. I didn't particularly know any Jewish people. And I didn't hear much about Israel at my church. And so I really came to with Corey's message through, that peace and joy and knowing how to live the Christian life and persevering through troubles. That was my initial attraction with her. But then as I realized what that family had done for the Jewish people, and more recently, I've been learning, some of the Jewish heritage that we have. We got our Bible from the Jewish people. Our Savior is Jewish. And so I began to study my Jewish roots. And
you have Jewish roots?
Well, we all, as believers, have okay. Jewish roots, yes. Right.
That's true, we do.
And I was able to go to Israel in 2007, and that was a wonderful experience. And I got to go the year in 2007, the year of Yom HaShoah, which is the day of remembrance of the Holocaust victims, fell on Corey's birthday. Hmm. And I was invited, my husband and I were invited to a ceremony at Yad Vashem, which is the Holocaust Museum there. And a very solemn ceremony. And there were Jews there from all over the world as well as foreign dignitaries. And you have never seen so much security any place as there that night. But it was absolutely holy. Hmm. It was just a beautiful ceremony. I mean, it was unforgettable.
Hmm. And so your love for the Jewish people began to develop as you got to know Corrie ten Boom and her family's story. Now, why did they risk their lives to hide Jews?
I'll tell you what Corrie's father said. Mm-hmm. Corrie said that her father taught them that hiding the Jewish people was simply the Christian thing to do. And in that family, there would have been no question. Hmm. And what Father said was when they began to be involved in the underground work, Father's friends told him that he was going to be put in prison for what he was doing. Mm-hmm. And he said, I'm too old for prison life, but for me, it would be an honor to give my life for God's chosen people. And that is what he did. He gave his life for God's chosen people, and he considered it an honor. The first time I delivered that line, I was in tears, because that is a very powerful thing.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. That is very
These
powerful.
These are God's chosen people.
Yeah. Well, you can see then how the Corey's heritage
yes,
so profoundly affected who she was as a person.
Yes.
You know, her father and mother, of course. Now, just to change gears a little bit from Corrie Ten Boom, you actually have quite a ministry in Arts Touching Hearts, and there's some other people that you've pulled in to use to reach people. And one of them is Laura Ingalls Wilder, who was, the authoress of Little House on the Prairie and the whole TV series with Michael Landon and all that good stuff. And she also wrote many other books. So how do you use Laura Ingalls Wilder in your work?
Well, I loved her from the time I was, a child reading those stories. And then I visited her home place and read more about her and found out that she had been writing in farm newspapers for 20 years before she wrote the Little House books. Her first book was published when she was 65 years old. And so it was like she had a simple, obscure life until she was old. And then she was catapulted to fame. And so in some ways, that's very like Corey.
Yes, that's true.
The God had been preparing her all along. So she is another person with a fascinating story that I also love to portray.
And so you portray her like you do Corrie Ten Boom. What's one scene from her life that you'd like to portray?
Well, I use a lot of those writings that she wrote prior to writing the Little House books, and a lot of it is about being thankful and just common everyday, the importance of work and being involved in things. And I remember I told one story, it's out of the Little House books, about Laura and Mary were arguing when they were children about what they were going to have with the Christmas turkey that Pa was getting. And they argued so much, and it ended up that he didn't get the turkey at all. And I remember I asked one little boy what they remembered from the talk, and he said, "Don't argue with your sister." And so I think they felt like, that sometimes we do anticipate our blessings before they come, that's not good.
Yeah, right. Well, one thing that I've read her biography and biographies about her life, even though the Little House books are biographical or autobiographical, they're not exactly exact portrayals. And her life, from my understanding anyway, was that. It was not the idyllic little prairie house kind of life that is portrayed, for example, in the TV series, that they actually moved from place to place to place, and her father was kind of a wanderer, and that was hard on the family, and they didn't have much because every time you moved, it was another hardship and everything. I don't know what you know about her life in reality versus how it's portrayed in the Little House books.
Well, she did have suffering and sorrow.
Right.
And she said she didn't want to bring those things into children, things that were too heavy, that weren't necessary. So in some ways, she was accentuating the positive things. And but she said her life was filled with sunshine and shadow. As all people's lives are. But I think she was dwelling more on the sunshine.
On the sunshine, because she was writing the books for children, so yeah. And they are marvelous books. Then the other ladies that you portray in a very interesting way, I don't know if you portray them, but you utilize their personalities, are Lucy and Ethel.
Yes,
from the beloved TV series, I Love Lucy. So how do you use Lucy and Ethel?
Well, everybody knows the I Love Lucy show,
Mm-hmm.
and I love that, and always had an image of, when I grow up, I'm going to have a friend like Ethel,
Sure,
and I'll
right.
be Lucy. And then I found out, that women were so busy that those kind of close friendships are very rare. And so I used them for a message about the importance of friendship and priorities in our life. And it's something that hits home with people because they all know them, and we can laugh at it. And we can also talk about forgiveness in those shows too, because Lucy and Ethel, they got mad at each other, and Fred and Ricky got mad at each other, but they got over it, and that is the thing. We're human beings and we're going to get that, but we need to have forgiveness with one another.
So what would be the way that you would make a point about Lucy and Ethel? Is do you use TV clips or do you dramatize their conversations or
Well,
what do you do?
I sort of, tell the scenario of what happened, and so many times people have watched those reruns. They know the shows, And one particular show, when they were mad at each other, they had tickets at a theater, and they didn't want to sit next to each other, because they weren't speaking. And but the show was on, the show they were watching, the play was about friendship, and so during that play, they start feeling sorry and they're sniffling, and then they've got their heads together at the end of the show. So
So cute, yeah. And then another person that you portray is in a totally different vein is Bob Dylan. And how did you pick Bob Dylan?
well, he's another one that I've loved since I was 16 years old, and I don't portray him, but I can usually find a line from one of his songs that really brings a principle home. Some beautiful theology in his songs, and just like you mentioned, you got to serve somebody, and if you're not serving the Lord, you're serving the devil. And I think we don't say that out loud, but
What do you know about Bob Dylan and his faith? I don't know too much about him. I know early on he certainly wasn't a man of faith,
no.
but what happened in his life, do you know?
He's Jewish, and he was bar mitzvahed from what I know, and but it would be in the 70s he came to a place of brokenness where he did come to know the Lord and was baptized and discipled, I guess you would say, in California. That's, I just know that from reading.
Right.
And
So what's one of his favorite songs or what's one of your favorite songs of his that you like to use?
well, I have favorite songs from every era, and he's constantly changing. And he has a new album out now, and one of the lines from it is, "I can't work up to you. You're going to have to work down to me someday." And that's what Christ has done for us.
Yeah.
We couldn't work our way up to him.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, he's an amazing guy with a unique sound and tremendous talent, that's for sure. And so how do you decide which people you're going to draw from for your ministry? Because this is a pretty diverse group.
Yes.
How do you decide that?
Well, I have located my interest in what God has worked in me over these years, and then when I get invitations to speak, then the people choose what they want.
What they want to hear. So if you were going to, now you have here something that you brought that is a something that I guess Corey's sister wove in concentration camp. Can you tell us a little bit about this?
Yes. Some of Corey's things, Corey died in California in 1983, and some of her things were donated to the Billy Graham Archives in Illinois. And I got to go up there to see some of the things that they had, and I found that they had this a replica of a hanky that Betsy had made in the prison camp. And she had on it, "The Lord will fight for you, and you need to be still. What else do you need, ladies?" And she decorated it. And I thought that Betsy had done that. And Betsy died in the camp of starvation. So here's this starving woman in a camp. And they didn't have hankies. They only had pieces of old sheets. And so she'd taken a little piece of cloth and written a Bible verse. That's Exodus 14:14. "The Lord will fight for you." And she was handing out to fellow prisoners, you know, as a witness. And I'm going, my goodness, this woman, you know, what a woman. And I thought, can we not hand out a word of encouragement to each other? Mm-hmm. I mean, we're not in a camp, you know. I mean, yeah. What's our excuse?
Yeah, it's true.
Anyway.
Well, that's a wonderful story to end on. Unfortunately, our time is up. Evelyn, it's been a joy to have you.
Thank you.
Yeah. So how do you feel about the life of Corrie Ten Boom and Evelyn's ministry in so many creative ways? Please let us know on Facebook, Twitter, or our website. Thank you for watching.